relation between invariance in the data and invariance in the network. I will not present it here, but you can find the paper that relates to it on my website. And we use the same strategy that I presented now to study the generalization error of general invariant classifiers, not only for deep neural networks, but for any classifier that have some invariance. And we draw a connection between the invariance that we have in the data and the invariance that we have in the classifier. And also we were able to propose a new strategy using our theory that enforce invariance in the network, and it improve the results of these networks. Yes?
I want to see if I understand the condition of Jacobian, basically. Talks about the condition number of the finger weight needs to be balanced more.
In some sense, yeah, you want to balance the thing. What you want a balanced network. So all these terms that we present, all of them try to balance the weights, like Miki stated before. And the Jacobian is a stronger way to balance these weights.
I have a question. How do you know that when you use, for example, the Jacobian, you do not harm the training error, for example? Indeed improve the generalization error, but what about the training error?
So,
for example, I can tell this about dropout as well. Dropout removes some of the weight, so of course you get a lower forbidding norm, but still, I don't know about the training here.
So this is a good question. Yeah, you want always when you use this at this regularization terms, you don't want to harm your convergence, or at least so. In some sense, with some regularizations, you have a trade-off between the regularization and the convergence. With others, you get everything. So with batch normalization, you get both better regularization and better convergence. With dropout, if we take it as an example, the convergence is usually 3 times or 2 times slower, but you get better regularization, but you get the same training error. So, of course, when you use this regularization, you should consider also the training error that you took. And this is it's important to try to balance between the two, to try to get a training error that is the smallest as possible, but at the same time with a generalization error that is small. And something you should keep in mind, that if you harm the training error, it doesn't necessarily mean that you harm the test error. But it's something that is contrary to the law. So now with the time that remained, I will go on the second. Other questions regarding the generalization error? So I have 10 more minutes or 20 more minutes?
20 more minutes.
So the second part, we'll try to understand how deep neural network resolve optimization problems. So, in this case, we will consider an inverse problem where we are given a measurement. We have an unknown signal Z that passes through a linear operator A, and the noise, and we have an added noise, and then we have a given set of measurements. Now, I want to. I want you to forgive me for the switched way of multiplying the vector and the matrix. The thing is that the first time I prepared these slides, or the first version of them, was when I made a tutorial with René Vidal for CBPR, and he used this convention, and I followed this convention, and since then, all the slides that I'm doing for about deep learning following this convention, maybe I should stop it somewhere. But anyway, so a standard technique for recovering Z from V is to minimize the L2 distance between the measurement that we have and the unknown vector times the linear operation with a certain constraint that Z belongs to a low-dimensional set. And I think that this summarizes most of the techniques in signal processing, that you minimize the and to loss with a certain constraint, and sometimes you have the unconstrained form of this minimization problem where you minimize the A to term between the measurements V and the unknown signal Z plus certain penalty function on Z. So these are very standard forms. Now, one example or one very popular minimization problem that follows from that is L1 minimization, where the penalty function is the L1 norm. And then this minimization problem can solve by the iterative shrinkage and thresholding algorithm, by the ISTA algorithm. But basically what it does, it takes a gradient step and then followed by a shrinkage, which is a simple nonlinearity, by soft thresholding operation, which is a simple nonlinearity that has this form. This is a standard technique, and it has a certain convergence rate. It needs about, for sparse data, it needs several hundred iterations to converge. One interesting strategy that was proposed to accelerate ISTA, of course there are many others, but one interesting one is the LISTA strategy, the learned ISTA. And in a minute we'll see its relation to neural networks. So if we take the ISTA iteration, we take the, and we will look at the gradient step, and we will rewrite it, we will see that we have a linear term that multiplies our previous guess ZT, and the linear term that multiplies the measurement. Gregor and LeCoumen in 2010 suggested to replace these two linear operations with two matrices X and S, and learn these X and S such that we'll get the fastest convergence with a limited number of iterations. And they showed that it is possible with a very small number of iterations to get almost to the same result that you achieve with hundreds of iterations by ISTA. And the question.
Get better results.
What? Sometimes you get better, sometimes you get. Okay. Sometimes you get better, sometimes you get the same one. Here you get better results. You get the same result of ISTA with a small number of iterations. And the question is why it is possible to do that. And interestingly, so. This result is not unique only for recovering of sparse data. So, the paper of Gregor and LeCoumen looked at sparse vectors and tried to recover the representation, the sparse representation by the LISTA, and to accelerate the ISTA by the LISTA. But Sprechmann, Alex Bornstein, and Sapiro showed that it is possible to do it for other types of models. Then Remes and Tanya and Bronstein showed that it is possible to do it for nonlinear inverse problems, for one pixel cameras. And more recently, Thompson, Schlatter, Sprechmann, and Perlin showed that it's possible to accelerate with LISTA some kind of Eulerian flows. So it's possible to use this strategy for many types of inverse problems. The question is why it is possible to do. So if we look at the LISTA, if we can write it as a neural network, or here some kind of a recurrent neural network, where we have linear part and nonlinear part, which depend on the minimization or on the penalty function that we are considering. And this structure of the LISTA has very similar structure, like the iterative hard thresholding operation, where the nonlinearity is the hard thresholding. We have the L1 minimization, where the nonlinearity is projection onto the L1 ball. If we look at the unconstrained L1 minimization, the nonlinearity is the soft thresholding that we have in the ISTA, and so on and so forth. As we said before, if you use the LISTA, we get improved convergence. In order to understand what the LISTA is doing, we study an algorithm which is very similar to LISTA, which is the projected gradient algorithm, where in the nonlinear part, instead of having the soft thresholding, we have a projection onto a certain set that obey that f of the vectors in this set is smaller than a certain number. So if f is the L1 norm, so this is the L1 ball. If it is the L0 ball, so it is the sparsity set, and this is the hard thresholding. And notice the difference that in, I didn't mention it before, but in the ISTA, the soft thresholding is the proximal mapping operation, which and in this algorithm we are considering only the projections. Okay, the proximal mapping is a projections are a special case of proximal mappings. So we considered only the case of projected gradient of algorithms like ISTA, but only with the case of projection. Very nice result by Oymak, Reft, and Sultano Kotabi showed that the convergence rate of the projected gradient algorithm scales as kappa times rho to the power of the number of iterations times the norm of the vector we are trying to recover. Now, in order to understand how this convergence rate behaves, I will skip some of the technical details and will just tell you that this convergence rate scales as something which is related to the parameter, to the ambient dimensions of the vectors that we are covering, and the Gaussian mean widths of the descent set of the function f that defined our set. Now, what is this Gaussian mean widths? This Gaussian mean widths is some kind of measure for the dimensionality of the data. And if, for example, we are considering sparse vectors with the L1 norm, the square of the Gaussian mean widths will be like the sparsity times log the ambient dimension. If we are looking at the Gaussian mixture model, with L1 we will have something that is order of the number of Gaussians that we have. So we have that the convergence of the PGD algorithm depends on the dimensionality or intrinsic dimensionality of the data that we work on. So our suggestion to accelerate the projected gradient algorithm is to try to use an inaccurate projection in the sense that let's assume the following. Let's assume that you are using PGD with a certain projection. And you are using a projection that depends on the function f. However, there is another function that is more complicated, f hat, that define a set that has a smaller Gaussian mean width. But the problem is that you don't know how to project on this set. So instead of projection on this set, till now we are using just the projection on this set, which is simpler with the PGD algorithm. So we suggest to do the following thing. We suggest to try to find a projection that inaccurately project on this set, that in each projection you get either on this set or with an epsilon error to this set, and therefore you have a small error that you add in each iteration. So our suggestion is that you, instead of projection on this more accurate set, you will project somehow on this set by adding a small error epsilon. And the way you will do that, you will use a linear projection followed by the previous non-linear projection. And this result with the inaccurate projected gradient algorithm. So in the PGD algorithm, we have here the 1 minus mu AA transpose, and here we have the mu AA transpose. And we add in the inaccurate PGD algorithm a projection P that if we combine it with the nonlinear projection that we had before, we get an inaccurate projection to the more accurate set. In this way, what we can do, what we can get a convergence rate that has two factors. It has the rho hat, which is, it depends on the Gaussian mean width of the smaller set, plus epsilon, which is the error that we are adding because of the inaccurate projection. So, if we will assume that epsilon is negligible compared to our convergence, we will get that our convergence rate has the behavior, the behavior that is very similar to the projected gradient descent algorithm, but with the difference that we will have convergence that depends on rho hat, which depends on the smaller set, plus the error epsilon that we had. And in some sense, if epsilon is much smaller than the convergence, or than the error that we get from the convergence till now, the error that we will get will be, the convergence rate will be almost the same, like if from the beginning we would use the accurate projection on the infeasible set that we don't know how to project. So I will show one example on how to use that. Let's assume that our set is a sparsity set, but that has a tree structure. Now, we have this tree structure, and let's assume that the coefficients in the lower places of the tree are very small. Now, in 2010, it was proposed that if we have these structures, it is possible to project directly on a tree structure and then to accelerate the convergence. We show that we can try to use some kind of inaccurate projections to accelerate this the convergence of the PGD if we have a limited budget in the number of iterations. So, if we look at the PGD, the standard PGD, so it is the blue line, so it has certain convergence. Now, instead of, if we will use the PGD with projection on the tree structure, we'll get faster convergence, but instead of that, we project only on several levels of the tree. So, we run the PGD such that with inaccurate projection, such that we ignore certain levels of the tree. So that when we ignore these levels of the tree, we add an error that is the size of, is the energy of the coefficients that we just ignored. So you can see that if we use IPGD just with keeping the first three levels, we don't get convergence at all because the epsilon is very large. If we use IPGD just with the first two tree levels, we get faster convergence at the first iterations, but then it saturates at a certain level because we have the coefficients that we ignored. And then the more tree levels that we get a slower convergence, but faster than the PGD. And this shows us the concept that we propose, that if we have a limited number of iterations, we can ignore some parts of our space, and in this way get a faster convergence. We showed that also for spectral compressed sensing, and for compressed sensing with coherent dictionaries. Now, the interesting thing is that our theory also explains why, or provide an explanation for why LISTA converge faster. Because in some cases, we have no idea what is this inaccurate projection P should be. So instead of trying to guess what is this projection, we can use the same strategy that was used by Borger and LeCun, and learn the whole matrices, and in this way, let the network know what are these inaccurate projections. Now, this provides us with some understanding of how to accelerate the LISTA, and we propose a LISTA mixture model. And if you think about it, so if one LISTA approximates our set with inaccurate projection, if we will use several LISTA, maybe we will be able to have with each of them a better approximation of a certain part of their set, and then get faster convergence. So we get faster convergence with that. I will just mention several related works there. In parallel to our work, there are several works that try to explain why Lista converge faster. Bruna et al. Showed that the convergence rate can... that the reason that Lista succeed is due to some kind of preconditioning of A. Xin et al. Showed that draw a relation between the Lista and the restricted isometry property of the matrix A. Schnitter and his colleague showed a connection to approximate message passing, but all this work considered only the case of sparsity, and we consider general low dimensional model. So I want just to thank my colleagues in these works, Guillermo Sapir from Duke, Yonina Eldar from the Technion, Alex Bronstein, but he's also from the Technion, Miguel Rodriguez from UCL, and Yuri Sokolich from UCL. Thank you very much.
Can you change your projection dynamically? I mean, you showed that in the tree example, this synthetic convergence rate. Can you enlarge the set on which you are projecting in order to gain better convergence?
Yeah, this should be done. Okay. So one of the things that you can do with the tree example is to try the first iteration, project only of the two levels,
yeah,
and then add levels gradually. Basically, I didn't mention that, but in Lista, what you do, you train the same linear operation for all the layers, but when you have the soft thresholding, so for each layer, you pick different thresholding values, and therefore you are able, in some sense, relax more and more and reduce this epsilon throughout the iteration.
And have you been able to show that this is more efficient than any concrete example? I mean, if you actually do better in another nova.
So this is mainly a theoretical work. So the Lista mixture model that it provides improvement. The problem is that when you multiply things, we have more parameters, so we have some kind of trade-offs. So Lista get most of the advantage. So then you have some residual, so that if it's very important for you to get a faster convergence, you can use multiple Listas and then in smaller number of iterations to get a better result.
As a follow-up to that question, say you do that, and then you do a few iterations with only the first layer, and then you increase the complexity of your set. How come then, in the graph that you showed, eventually they plateau, and they do not keep... You keep increasing the layers of the tree, but...
No, I didn't do that.
No?
So I just...
There, so...
Yeah, I just here with two, I just fix the number of...
Sure, yeah, yeah.
So what I could do, I could here...
Yeah, yeah, switch.
Switch.
Exactly, but
then
my question
when
is...
switch, I would jump to this graph, and then I would jump to this graph, and then I would jump to this graph.
Yeah, my question is why the error, when you use five levels, and four layers, and three levels, is essentially the same, and they do not keep increasing.
Because the coefficients... You have a small difference here. Because the magnitude of the elements in the tree, when you go lower, the way we builded this coefficient is very small, so the difference is not very... The difference is negligible.
He's asking, what is it
plateau? Why it's plateau? Because
right,
we have this error epsilon. So if you will look at our theory, so you can see that basically what you get is this convergence rate plus epsilon. So when t goes to infinity,
could you decrease epsilon then?
Yeah, so when you add more layers, you decrease epsilon. So basically what you can do, you can start with...
And then fall back into the projected gradient.
Yeah.
Descent.
You can start with this,
and then
fall back to the projected gradient descent, and you will get faster convergence.
Okay.